introduction. He's one of our three leaders and our resident environmentalist. He lives his values through the work he does here at NYSEC and with the young people he teaches and mentors at Groundwork Hudson Valley. He's the National Youth Director for the U.S. National Park Service. Is that correct?
For Groundwork USA.
Groundwork USA Office of the National Park Service. He tries to live a low-impact lifestyle, and he teaches us how to do the same in his monthly sustainable living circle, which there will be one this afternoon at 1:30. Kurt is finally going to answer the burning question, how many light bulbs, how many Americans does it take to change a light?
I like that ballad song, too. I remember Inch by Inch, sung by John Denver on The Muppet Show. Does anyone remember that? I thought he wrote it. Of course, got me from South Texas, and never heard, only listening to country music and didn't know anything that there was a world outside of Texas. But I remember him being on that show. You know, John Denver, I had to give him credit where credit was due. You know, simple country boy in many ways. Again, he was an ardent environmentalist before it was really kind of cool to do this. Took a lot of heat for doing so. He even testified before Congress on a number of environmental issues and was brutally attacked in the media and everything else. After one of those forays, of course, he went back to Colorado and wrote Home Again. Hey, it's good to be back home again. Sometimes this old farm feels like a long lost friend. Hey, it's good to be back home again. I fixed the phrase. He was actually very interested in creating light environmental transportation modes. In fact, he died flying an experimental aircraft that he was piloting. So he was a pretty amazing guy when you think about how people can come from pretty simple roots and really become great spokesmen. So how many Americans does it take to change a light bulb? It seems like it's an amazingly more complicated thing. Of course, light bulb jokes have been around for a long time. Everybody's got their favorite ones. You usually take, you know, your favorite group and insert them. You know, like, I'm from Texas A&M. I got my degree there. How many Aggies does it take to change a light bulb? About 23,001. One to hold the light bulb and 23,000 to rotate the house. You know, jokes like that. How many New Yorkers does it take to change a light bulb, right? One to call the electrician and one to make the martinis. I'm trying to think of a lot of right there. How many Upper West Siders does it take to change a light bulb? And that's probably one to call the super and one to donate to the AFL-CIO for the exploitation of labor to change the light bulb. So, or one of my favorite ones is how many creationists does it take to change a light bulb? None, because apparently like, they prefer to remain in the dark. But here we come, 2014 in the United States, new light bulb law has kicked in, finally phasing out the 40-watt, the 60-watt bulb. This is part of a communist plot, of course, to according to some people, to remove the light bulbs that started under which president? George Bush. George Bush helped pass the laws in 2007 that planned for the obsolescence of the light bulbs. And so the 100-watt bulb and the 75-watt incandescent light bulb has gone the way of the dinosaur, followed by this year by the 60 and the 40-watt light bulbs. So more and more changes are happening. Interestingly enough, you may find this shocking, the United States is behind most industrial nations in handy light bulbs because they were invented by God or something like that. And he wants us to have incandescents. But they're banned in most countries of the world. We're about in the middle of the pack with that. Actually, interestingly enough, third world countries are leading the way. In fact, they were banned in Brazil starting in 2004 and Kenya much earlier, simply because they make so much sense for struggling countries, especially who don't have large infrastructures to power incandescent light bulbs, which make absolutely no sense. You know, we've loved them ever since Thomas Alva Edison over there in New Jersey invented the light bulb. With his tungsten filament. What was his first filament, the light bulb? Do you know? It was carbonized bamboo, right? That's the first successful one was carbonized, and then he went to tungsten because the thing heats up to, what, 4,107 degrees or something like that, and that's why it glows so hot. And of course, to keep it from exploding, we have it in a vacuum tube, and there you go, we have the electric light. The light bulb change needs to happen in this country as it does around the world for a variety of reasons. I mean, it must take a couple of the environmental gifts from us simply changing a light bulb. There is, hopefully now going forward, 75% less mercury in our atmosphere. Now, I'm going to talk about mercury later on because that usually is something when people get mad about compact fluorescence. But there's 75% less mercury going to be now in our atmosphere because we're burning less coal to power that, right? 20% of America's light power expenditures goes to turning on lights. 20%. It's amazing. We spend almost as much energy on lights as we do in transportation in this country. Most people fail to remember that, how much, what energy hogs that they are. There's going to be less arsenic in our streams, unless you live in West Virginia, where they seem to like it. But there'll be less arsenic in our streams because the amount of arsenic that gets released from the burning of coal that's floating across our atmosphere, and it comes down not only in other toxic chemicals like acid rain in our streams, but also raining down arsenic in our streams as well. They estimate that we'll be able to eliminate 14 coal-fired power plants just by changing the light bulbs in this country. 14 power plants, getting rid of them totally because they are so much more efficient than standard incandescent bulbs, right? They're 80% more efficient. They're going to help us deal with climate change. We need to deal more than that. Your standard compact fluorescent or LED bulb saves about 450 pounds of CO2 from the atmosphere. 450 pounds. So magnify that by the number of lights in this nation, and you can see that's a large amount of CO2 gas that's going to be permitted to float out there and lead to climate change. If you run a 100-watt bulb for an hour, 100-watt incandescent light bulb for 100 hours, it's the same as burning a gallon of gas, just to put that in things. So if you have a 100-watt light bulb still, some of you probably went on and hoarded them, and you have them in your house somewhere, like most Americans, they all went out and bought all these thousands of bulbs that were wiped out of the shelves in some states. You know, people are now smuggling them in from Mexico, which, by the way, that's getting rid of their incandescent light bulbs as well. So your days are numbered, you better start buying them now. There's no more available on the shelf, so good luck with that. But if we were to, so a standard 100-watt light bulb burns about 1 gallon of gas for every 100 hours that you do that. These new bulbs have cut that down by a third, just to show you the amount of carbon dioxide that gets released in there. It's pretty amazing. It's going to reduce the amount of junk going into our landfills. I know that doesn't make sense to you. You think it's not that much, but when they look at the amount of tons of lights and lighting fixtures and things like that that end up in our light fixtures because of these throwaway bulbs, the incandescent light bulbs, it's going to help, of course, reduce that. It'll cool your house in summer, right? A standard incandescent light bulb produces about 85 British thermal units of heat per bulb, whereas these new compact fluorescents and LEDs only produce about 3. So you've all sent your finger turning, picking out a light bulb, they're very, very hot. You magnify that by the average household of 4 to 5 bulbs on at any given time, they do heat your house, and of course lead you to turn the air conditioner down more. So they say there are other impacts that will have to do with fuel savings just from the amount of lights that people often have in their rooms. As you know, that the incandescent light bulb is so inefficient that when you hit it with a bunch of energy, 10% of the energy that we hit it is converted into light. 80% of the energy is converted into heat, which is the reason why they're really great for, you know, brooding chickens or something like that, but they're not really great for having in your house. So we need less power stations, we're going to need more conservations, they're much more efficient, and there are a lot of reasons that we can do that. These bulbs will also save you money. Each a standard compact fluorescent bulb. That's not like an advertisement for GE. A standard compact fluorescent bulb or an LED bulb will save you between $80 and $100 per bulb off your electric bill. So each month, if this standard person family were to change four light bulbs, four to five, you could save between $400 to $500 a year off your electric bill, depending on the size of your house and how many of these things that you go on there. Our goal, of course, in this nation was to get at least five of your bulbs changed in each house. If we could get each of you to replace this marvelous thing, at least five of your most commonly used bulbs, it would make quite a bit of difference. And of course, they're simply just more efficient, not only because of energy use, but because of lighting. Usually an incandescent bulb produces 16 lumens, which is a measure of light, of brightness, 16 lumens per watt. So a 100 watt bulb produces about 16 lumens per watt. So a 100 watt bulb would be 1600 lumens. Well, these new efficient bulbs can give you about 15 to 1600 lumens for 25 watts or so. So they're quite more efficient, about 53 lumens per watt. So for all those reasons, and for many, many others, we should have changed the light bulbs quite a bit. You know, the argument I have with groundwork always runs is we run a floating farm called the Science Barge. It's in downtown Yonkers, and it's a farm that we power with solar and wind turbines and everything else. And I usually give a talk, and the argument that I often hear people say is, you don't understand, America uses this much energy, and our renewables are only about this much. You've heard that argument. And even if we were to double them or quadruple them, we would never meet all of America's energy needs. That's the argument. But as the Lawrence Livermore laboratories show, this much of American energy is wasted. Right? Half of all the energy we create in this country, half of all the energy we create is wasted. And if we did nothing else but change light bulbs, produce more fuel-efficient cars, modify these old buildings, if we just did those things, we wouldn't even need as many invested dollars in alternative energies because we wouldn't be such big energy hogs. So that's part of that. So why the big complaint then? Changing the light bulbs created mass hysteria in the streets that were burning buildings and people were rioting, and it was not here, I think it was in Texas, which is where I'm from, so I can talk about that. Why did the people get so angry and so upset? Why are people so afraid about changing their light bulbs and putting in more fuel-efficient light bulbs? It's a really, really interesting question, and a lot of people have looked at this. So I think we should start by asking the other side, what was their reasoning? What were they so afraid of? Or, you know, what did they think was, that sounds like a pejorative term, what were their concerns? And why did they think they wanted to keep these little diminutive energy hogs? And at first, of course, one of the main arguments is, it's another example of the government telling us what to do. Sometimes I hate to break it to them, but they would be surprised at how much government regulates stuff in their environment. I mean, from what goes into their toothpaste, what you eat, where our food is grown, how it's marketed, what's in your shampoo, the safety of your car, the rules governing your checking account, all the things around clean air, clean water, the sizes of virtually everything. There are lots of government standards. And sometimes they were not there simply because the government wants to control everything we do. Sometimes industries themselves got together to create the standards and to raise those. And we need some government standards despite what people might say. So it is true, it's another example of the government telling us what to do with a light bulb and all sorts of stuff. But those incandescent light bulbs have a lot of rules on top of them that people don't even realize. The fact that how much heat they could generate because they were afraid at one time to cause fires. So there were lots of different kinds of rules on the old light bulbs, but the new light bulbs, of course, have those as well. And yes, we are asking Americans to convert to new kinds of light bulbs because we cannot continue to throw away that amount of energy. Energy, as you know, is getting very expensive. And the types of energy that we have, that we produce so much of it, is so toxic that we need new rules around this. So yes, someone is going to tell you what to do. If it's not your government, maybe it's your mom, I hope, but someone's going to tell you to be much more efficient in how you live. Their other big complaint is that we should have let the free market make the changes that we're needing. You know, that's my the joke. How many supply side economists does it take to change a light bulb? You know, the answer is none. If you let the light bulb stay in the darkness, eventually the darkness will make it come back on somehow. It's a magical way that the market is going to change and make things. Red State blogger, a guy named Eric Erickson, was rolling with the internet for a while, writing feverishly about this, and he got, surprisingly, a bunch of congressmen in Texas to write bills, of course, to turn over. There was a Ted Poe of Texas congressman to get him to introduce bills that would do away with the energy efficient light bulbs for a number of reasons. And their biggest complaint, they said, well, we shouldn't let the industry handle it. In fact, they said, look at cars. They're much more energy efficient today because the market is the one who wanted to create much more energy efficient vehicles. Really? Really? Is that how we created more fuel efficient cars in this country? It wasn't two things. You people saying, I'm tired of a car that gets 12 miles to the gallon because I don't want to pay so much, and business, the government saying, you need to raise your fuel efficiency. It wasn't that. I was just surprised at that argument. In fact, there is no incentive for many car manufacturers to do away, to make more fuel efficient cars. And if some of us are old enough to remember that every time we raised fuel efficiency, it was a major fight in this country by business. So the suggestion that business would handle this and make this better because just look at the cars is somewhat laughable. Someone said, well, look at cell phones. You know, cell phone batteries are much more efficient. They keep looking at it to make it more so that your cell phone doesn't last just one day because we use much more downloading. Who were the people who were arguing and how quickly their cell phones were doing? Was it business? No, it was the consumers. And the consumers were basically getting mad that, shoot, I just paid $400 for the phone and I can use it 6 hours in a day. And now, of course, they produce more efficient types of cell phones with that longer battery lives. There was a Harvard economist named Michael Porter. Some of you may like him and actually support him. This is he's a professor of business who actually thought that, well, it doesn't really make sense for businesses necessarily to get involved in social change. Originally, that was his big argument for a number of reasons. First of all, that social change should be done by governments, by nonprofit organizations. This was his original argument, that they're much better to do it because if I am the CEO of a company and I start to say, listen, ladies and gentlemen, stockholders, I'm going to start changing the efficiency of our products and make them much greener, you would go, no, that's our right, not your right, to do that. In fact, we'd be much more efficient if we just spent the money that you want to do on these on making improvements. But Michael Porter had a change of heart because of an article that was in the Wall Street Journal a few years ago about this, this fact. And he went 360 and he thought, no, actually business should get involved in social ventures. That businesses can make the world a better place, that they can create jobs, they can do many things. And his argument was, look at how much assets are owned by different groups. So for example, in this country, supposedly nonprofit organizations and NGOs have about $500 billion in assets. That's what they can do that they're throwing towards social justice problem. The government has about $3 trillion in assets that it can throw towards social problems. And business, he says, has $20 trillion in assets that it can throw to the social problems. And all businesses need to do is say that social improvements are good for business. So for example, you would think that governments, he says, the old model is that the government had to step in with OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, and tell governments, businesses to make the work environment more safer. Well, luckily, thanks to lawsuits, Most businesses now know that it's better to make and more money efficient for them to make a better work environment, and they'll save money. That was one of his chief arguments. The fact is, the truth is, that if GE wanted to invent a more efficient light bulb, it wasn't because it wanted to do it. GE invented more efficient energy light bulbs because of consumer demand and because of government regulation. That is why they created much more energy efficient light bulbs. And in fact, people have been trying to find incentives to get businesses to make the types of changes that we're asking for, and no one has ever been found them. And then surprisingly enough, how many of you ever heard of the documentary, The Lightbulb Conspiracy? Anybody? So go Google it, it's one of those conspiracies. Now, I think I don't like conspiracies. I think they're examples often of circular reasoning and confirmation bias and all these other things that I, as the philosopher side of ego, you're making these errors of mistakes. However, the story goes that all of the lightbulb manufacturers in the world got together in about the late 20s, and they got together to have a conference in which they said the problem with the light bulb is we're making them too good, right? There's that famous city, Livermore, California, I think it's called, that has that fire station that has that light bulb that's been on since now 100 and something years, right? It was built in the 1920s, the light bulb's there. People go there and ask a big vacation site and take pictures of it and all this kind of stuff. It's still burning. And their argument was is that's what a lot of the original light bulbs were made to do, to last for a long period of time because people did not have money. In fact, in the documentary, they look at the advertising of the original light bulbs and they all said that they should burn for at least 2,000 hours, and that was the standard across industry. So the problem is people were making light bulbs, there wasn't that much electricity anyway, and people were making these bulbs to last. Well, supposedly this group got together in Europe and said the problem with that is everybody has a light bulb already and we need to do something new. We need to create something called planned obsolescence. And the idea is to make products less efficient and less built so well so that they would run out and so industry would survive because it would go off and buy. We would go out and buy new things that we keep breaking and having to replace, right? Our disposable society. I cannot tell you the number of fights that I had with Home Depot around their power tools because I work with youth. We're out there, you know, doing landscaping and building and construction and all this kind of stuff. And invariably the youth break the power tools and I go back and they go, "We'll just throw it away and get a note. It's not worth fixing." Next person who tells me that. But still, I keep buying more and more and more expensive pieces of equipment, of course, so that they could be repaired, but that happened. But according to this documentary, the group called Phoebus got together and decided to change the standards in this country so that light bulbs would be less efficient in a way and would burn out after 1,000 hours, not 2,000 hours. The fact is that conspiracy was true. There is plenty of documentation to show this. There were a lot of reasons that even government supported it because they were afraid of the light bulbs getting too hot. That was one of the arguments, maybe they'll cause more fires, and that therefore they should turn down the heat or make them out of flimsier materials because of the heat regulations. But for whatever reason, after that period, all of a sudden across the United States, it says, and this light bulb will burn for 1,000 hours. That was the new standard because people weren't even paying attention that the light bulbs, of course, could burn for much more longer than that. So planned obsolescence, of course, is one of the other reasons why many of our products, but specifically the light bulb, and we'll talk about the other conspiracy things that they have because they're a little frickier, but the light bulb was designed to be something only to last for a short period of time, and then it would break, and then you would have to buy new light bulbs. People like to do that. The other concern, of course, of these light bulbs has to do with what? Why don't people like compact fluorescent light bulbs? What do you think is the biggest complaint? Mercury. Mercury. They have mercury in them. Right? So the way an incandescent light bulb works is you got a current flying, going through a small coil piece of tungsten wire in a vacuum. It heats up to 4,107 degrees and grows so bright. That's how we have the lights in here. Fluorescent lights, of course, work a different way. They essentially have argon gas or a little bit of mercury vapor inside of them. They have basically what was a cathode ray on both sides that then pulsates and sends energy through the gas, creating an ultraviolet light. They then take a piece of glass and they coat it with phosphor, which is a type of salt that comes from the ground. It glows when you hit it with energy. And so you put phosphor inside of a tube, you hit it with ultraviolet light, and that's how lights turn on. They flicker because they would burn out if you kept them on. So actually, as you all know, they pulse, so they flicker at very, very fast rates, supposedly so that we don't notice them. And some of you have migraines, so you do notice it. But fluorescent lights, of course, pulse because they cannot stay on all the time. So they do have mercury inside of them. They have 4 milligrams mercury inside of them, which is about the same amount as what you would think it would fill the dot of an end of a sentence, all right? So that's 4 milligrams. Mercury is a neurotoxin and is very bad for women, pregnant women, and for little children. Just like a lot of the heavy metals, our body is designed to use metals like zinc and iron. We need them in our blood, we need them in how we construct our bones and everything else. And so metals, of course, are supposed to be there. They have this kind of attachment. And unfortunately, some other bad metals that are not supposed to be in our body plug into that little connector in our neurons just fine. And therefore, kids, of course, that are exposed to this can lead to all kinds of neurological diseases and things like that. Mercury is a bad substance, which is the reason why we should not be letting it go into our atmosphere and why we need to cut back 75% of it through incandescent light bulbs. But people are afraid, of course, because the compact fluorescent bulb has a little bit of mercury in it, 4 milligrams. The World Health Organization and the EPA keep arguing over what's the safe level. This is 4 milligrams. What is safe for us is we can ingest between 6 and 20 micrograms, quite a bit smaller, of mercury, they think, without having the impact on us. So here's an interesting question. Where do you get most of your mercury from? Where do humans, get most of your mercury from that we ingest? Fish, tuna fish sandwiches. So if you've had 8 tuna fish sandwiches or 8 servings of fish in a year, you've had more mercury you've eaten than is what is in this light bulb. Now, I'm not trying to downplay that mercury is bad. Mercury is bad. We should eventually get around it. In fact, you can through by having LED lights where the compact fluorescent bulb. But there is very little bit of vapor inside this bulb. And in fact, that was the big concern, is that when this thing breaks, what they tell you to do, of course, is not handle it the way you traditionally would handle an incandescent light bulb. In fact, the story was that there was a woman in Massachusetts. She had this light bulb break, and she called her local. She knew that there was mercury in there, so she called her local environmentalist or something like that, some organization, and they said, yes, we can send a hazmat team over there, and it's going to cost $2,000 to clean up your apartment. The problem with this story is it's not completely true. The woman did call. The company says, well, yeah, you can have your apartment cleaned for about $2,000, but that's not what they said. Well, the recommendation is open the window, air out your room for a little bit, take the stuff, put it in a sealed container, and return them in. Now, I love the fact that story gets told. I want people to be afraid of mercury. I do not want mercury in the landscape, so I want every single neocon and liberal in this country raising a stink about mercury so that we can write precisely the kinds of bills that even those on the conservative right are pushing for, which is that if someone sells you a bulb, they have to take the bulb back, right? Now, most of you, of course, have thermometers in your house that have 100 times more mercury in them. If you're having a hearing aid battery or watch battery, you've got 3 grams of liquid of mercury in there. Mercury symbol, of course, is like HG. So if you ever see an HG on any package, you know what that means. That stands for hydroiodril, which means in Greek, liquids, silvery water is what it stands for. So this has an HD symbol that tells people in there, and I want rules about that. I want people to do that. But the fact is that these new compact fluorescent bulbs are actually much safer because, like this, it's wrapped inside of plastic, or they're inside those, they look like light bulbs now, they have those little plastic bulbs, but there's inside feathers, a different kind of thing. And that's all to contain the mercury. And all you do is take it back to the manufacturer. Just like you all do with your batteries, right? None of you throw a battery in the trash, correct? You take them all back, right? When you do, and you get rid of your computers, you never put a CPU monitor out by the street or a computer, right? That has to go back to the store too. Yeah, and you never throw your cell phones away in the trash, that has to go back too. You're all doing that, right? For sure, because you're good ethical people. So this light bulb needs to go back. In fact, I have something for you. I have a bulb for nearly everybody in this room. I'm going to pass these out around. They're compact fluorescent bulbs. These are daylight bulbs, which means they're very, very, very bright. They're about 100 lumens, standard like 100 watt bulb type thing. They're only 25, 27 watts so of energy usage. This one bulb, it says, will save you $80 off your electric bill. So if you already have a house full of these bulbs, don't take one. But if you want one, I've got enough for probably everybody, every household to have one. So I'm going to have my helpers pass these around. And I'm going to take, before I move on, any questions that any of you might have about these little communist plots here. Any questions that I can answer? Yes, ma'am. There's the microphone, is right there. This guy lasts up to 9 years. It's a daylight bulb, which means it mimics daylight. My roommate says, we changed all our light bulbs a long time ago, compact fluorescents, and I had some leaves and I did it. He says it's too bright. So. Okay, yes, question one first.
Can you explain LED?
LED, light emitting.
Are they available?
Yes. So LEDs, light emitting diodes, of course, are a completely different technology. There is no mercury whatsoever in an LED bulb. In fact, there's more mercury, by the way, in the manufacture of incandescent light bulbs than there are even inside of these things. What's good about LED bulbs is they use even less energy. They're about 9 watts. This is 27 watts. They're about 9 watts, and they can last up to 23 years. So one LED bulb, you only need a couple of those in your entire life to last up. You should donate them like your inheritance to your kids. I leave you my light bulb collection. So you should buy them. They are much more expensive. The really, really good quality ones can run up to $23 a light bulb, but you only buy one the rest of your life. The other thing that people didn't like about the LED bulbs originally is they weren't in a full spectrum. It was hard to get the full spectrum of light for LED bulbs, and that problem was solved about 4 years ago. So you can actually get LED bulbs in the full spectrum. Next question. Back there is, oh, I'm sorry, there's the one who's got the microphone. This will make sure you get it back over there.
You probably think I'm horrible, but I only have halogen lights. What about them?
Halogen gas lights? And you have halogen lights in your house?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What is the wattage rating of those things? Do you know? Let's just talk about the wattage. You know what they're... Check the wattage for that. I mean, I think halogen, of course... You're going to have two problems. We use halogen lights on the science barge when we want to heat the ceilings. They can be pretty hot. It's one of the things that are very bright. And they're very hot, but they're great for like spotlights and things like that. Yeah, for spots, they're great. So you can have halogen lights, but I've seen micro spots and micro halogens. I think they can be as high as 140 watts, so I think you can get them as low as about 60 to 80 watts, I think.
Yeah, you can. I heard that they're going to I have halogen in certain places. And I heard that they're going to discontinue
halogen. Probably for the same reason that they're energy hogs.
And I have all
yes. Yes, ma'am.
Besides mercury, what are the other products that are used to manufacture those light bulbs? In other words, is there another downside to the mass use of? Because each light bulb may just use a little tiny bit, but we're talking about millions and billions.
Sure. Yeah. In fact, there's the biggest amount of mercury that's in the New York City water system and our sewer system is from amalgam that the dentist used in your teeth, right? So most of us had cavities that were filled with mercury, right? Just so you know. right? And every time a dentist mixes up that stuff, it's still commonly used, as it has been since 1853, amalgam has been used. We all have that liquid mercury stuck into our teeth, it mixes with metals, it turns nice and hard, and you ingest, they think, about 6 micrograms a year from your mercury, from your fillings, which ends up in the stream of things like that. So that's the biggest thing. These light bulbs, of course, have 4 milligrams of mercury vapor in them. The rest of it is argon gas. The phosphorescence, the white coating, you ever, you know, broken a phosphorus tube open, a fluorescent tube in, and you run your finger and it's like a powder. It's actually a type of salt called phosphorus. It's a rock. They grind it up, they spray it on the inside of your light bulb with an organic mix. They bake it in an oven and it adheres to the glass. That stuff is not toxic in the forms that we have. So there probably, the rest of the light bulb is no more toxic than any other toxic thing we made in this country.
I used to always use an incandescent in the bathroom because they used to say that fluorescents use a lot more energy when you first turn them on and the bathroom light goes on and off. So are these new bulbs better for that?
Correct. So that was another big thing there. This is called a quick start bulb. I think it says somewhere on here. Quick start bulbs. That was one of the problems is you're exciting a gas. The gas is creating an ultraviolet light, and then that ultraviolet light is exciting the phosphorus that's painted on the inside of tubes, and then all that was happening. This is a quick start bulb. Yeah, instant on bulb right here. They've kind of eliminated some of that problems. Actually, they think you should put one of these in your bathroom for the reason that for a lot of people, when they wake up in the morning, this is a little bit brighter. This is the daylight bulb. And for those of you who suffer from seasonal affect, as I do, I feel happier. And for some reason, I keep thinking when I walk by, I leave the light in the bathroom on sometimes, I walk by the door and I go, is the light coming in there? And I go, no, it's just my daylight bulb. But yeah, that was a problem. They couldn't be used to dimmers originally for that similar kind of things because of the weirdness of the power. Remember that they don't stay on all the time. A regular light bulb is hit with energy the entire time. These pulse, so they have a ballast, right? And that ballast is actually flickering amounts of electricity, which is the reason why they use all this electricity. And a lot of those things now have been overcome, those challenges. Yes?
So I notice on the bottom right, it says these bulbs are good for these types of lamps, which are both open lamps. And in my apartment, I have a bunch of closed lamps.
You have sconces or something like that, like bulbs?
Well, they're like boob lights.
Yeah.
They're closed. Yeah. And I've noticed that compact fluorescents burn out after several months in those lights.
Right, so there is a big debate. This is made from some rare country called, I think it's pronounced Chine. There is some argument in this country that compact fluorescent bulbs were no better than other bulbs because they burned out really, really quick. Part of that is the fact that we had to go tell the manufacturers in Chine of the standards of American quality. If you say a lamp lasts this many years, it needs to last maybe this many years. So there was a lot of bulbs that got returned by manufacturers. Like Home Depot just sent back huge truckloads of them to China a few years ago because they burnt out. They weren't anywhere near the efficiency. Now because we are telling the manufacturer, we used to just order the bulbs for them. Now we say, here's the standards and what we want them to do. That is less of an issue. All fluorescent bulbs don't do well in situations where you're turning them on and off. So if you're in a place where, they're not that great for your refrigerator, for when you roll them. But they wear out over time if you keep turning them on, turning them off, those kind of stuff. Fluorescent bulbs, basically turn them on, they glow a little bit, and then kind of turn them off. That was the key issue. But they are getting better. And all we have to do is tell the manufacturers, which are mostly coming out of China, to do this. I'm happy to see that the politicians on the right, and God bless them, they are trying to push through laws in this country so that these would be manufactured here. And I'd rather see that anyway.
How do we know?
How do we know that we have high mercury in our body? Number one. And number two, how do we get rid of it?
Mercury poisoning has lots of different symptoms depending on your age. If you're a child, of course, it looks like it causes brain damage and developmental delays. If people are exposed to mercury, and adults, it can lead to things like hallucinations. You have mercury poisoning, it's a neuro, it interferes with neurotransmitters in your body. We have a doctor standing up in the back. Can you answer that question?
Just a quickie on that. Zinc and selenium protect you against mercury poisoning.
Right. So another reason to take more zinc.
Zinc and selenium in your multivitamin or in your food will protect you quite a bit.
Be more cruciferous vegetables. There's your answer right there. Microphone's on.
Yes. This is a quasi-romantic question, but not unusual to be in a restaurant and the sun's going down and they dim the lights and bring candles to each table and everyone goes, ah. So I guess I'd ask, is that an improvement or is that a diminution? Because wax and candles may have effects that we don't think about.
Well, of course, I use candles in my own house. So I'm one of those people who have big, huge candle lanterns and light my house with it. There's something to be said about the light spectrum of the traditional yellow lights. We've grown up with it. We're so used to it. How many of you saw the article that was in Los Angeles? They've just converted all of their street lights to LED. Did you hear that? And people in the film industry said, yes, but it lost that yellow glow that we used to have. And they're trying to now think if they could put filters on those good stuff, because people, if they see the new street lights in Los Angeles, they'll think, oh my God, there's something wrong here. By the way, those street lights are coming to New York, so get prepared. Nassau County's installing them as we speak, so.
I have a question myself, and it's about Con Ed. My electric bill is not going up, it's going down. And I'm right now battling them.
It's gone up.
It hasn't gone down. It keeps going up. And yet I also changed my light bulbs. I'm very frugal. Yes. And they'll come up with any answer.
Well, I'm not going to spend too much time on that question because it's a big intense question. You get charged for two kinds of way the electricity comes to your house. You get charged for the amount of electricity you use, and you get charged for the delivery system. If you're a person who likes to run your washer, your dryer, your vacuum, and your blender all at the same time, they love you because they then go and they buy the biggest pipe they can, technically speaking, and they plug that into your house. So you're paying for the biggest storage pipe. So you look on your bill, you have two. You have a delivery charge and you have a service charge. Fight the delivery charge, get it much lower, and stop running your air conditioner, washer, dryer, dishwasher, all at the same time. Wash your clothes like I do at night. Turn it on after 7 p.m. and then wash clothes in the evening. It's not a reminder of the day. Yes, other questions? We have time for a few more. Quite complex for us.
This is a question about mercury.
Yes.
Is it only a danger if the bulb breaks?
You're right. I mean, my biggest advice to you to keep mercury from this going into your body is don't eat this. Right? Don't eat this. It is, if you notice, this is called a shatterproof bulb. It has a plastic coating around it so that this does shatter. The mercury is actually trapped inside of a plastic container, which is how we moved to this country. So the arguments over mercury are becoming more and more moot because manufacturers, people are so afraid of these things, they just went and they solved the problem. That is one place where industry kind of caught up with the people. So no, there's no way to do that. Over time, like all fluorescent bulbs, the mercury vapor gets absorbed into the glass and it gets stuck there. It produces that, on a fluorescent light bulb, that telltale burn that looks dark on the corner of these. These do the same thing because they've been exposed over time. So this is about 9 years from now. Come and see me and see how it went, okay? Hopefully these are good bulbs. One last question. Hold on.
When you bring your bulbs back and your batteries back, what do they do with them?
So they're like when I was in Texas and I had hearing aid batteries by the thousands. Basically, what they do is I send them back to the manufacturers. Basically, I get a rebate, which actually saves me money because if they get so many of them in one place, it's better. If they're scattered and they have to dig them in landfills, it's not economical. But if they get thousands of these bulbs back, they send them back, they extract the stuff out of this.
So the expectation is that the store will send them back?
Yes, okay. Is that the source is supposed to send them back.
And are they required to accept them?
They are required to accept them. Okay. Now, good luck sometimes with that, but they are required in all the big box stores. Okay. Of course, I hope you get one and refuse you, because then there's a great environmental campaign. I'll take it. So I had one last question.
Staples stores have a little box, and you bring it back.
Right by the cash register.
Pardon?
Right as you exit the store.
Yeah, right. So you bring your batteries and dump them in there.
Batteries, your cell phones, they'll take anything that they sell.
And they're very good about it.
Yeah, and there are being more laws being written once again by, luckily by the other side of the aisle, so they'll go through, that says this has to be taken back to the manufacturers.
Oh, the last question is, I live in a senior residence with about 200 other seniors, and if I had a piece of paper, which I could give to maintenance, to convince them to change their bulbs to ones that are environmentally friendly, I could do that.
Yes, I mean, the fact is, you will save, if you're in a co-op, or if you're in a partner, or you're part of any big groups that has these bulbs, and you're paying maintenance fees, or some co-op fees, or whatever doing, you're paying for electricity costs in the lobby, and those type of things, this will save the co-op money. So it just makes sense, just like in your own household, to reduce your bill by doing this. So
you know what flyers I can give them, and because for me to explain it.
You have to call me.
Okay.
All right, thanks, Lyon. So, I want to come up to the last issue in our remaining few minutes about why people are so resistant to change. And it has, I was trying to think about it myself, and I'm going to tell you why I did not like Yankees as a kid. Right, being in rural South Texas. I was in a very, very, very small town out in the middle of nowhere, and we lived 4 miles outside of town, so we lived 4 miles outside of nowhere. And it was a beautiful place. It was extremely hot and sun-baked, and you could just see the Inca doves playing in the ground, and the Bob White singing, and the air smelled like that kind of burnt sugar of the mesquite. It was a gorgeous type of place. And as a kid, my fear when we went into San Antonio, Texas, and every time we drove there, it was almost a different city. It was growing so fast. Is that somehow we were going to lose all this. We were going to lose a way of life and a culture that was unique to my place. That was my fear. I mean, we didn't listen to rock. I didn't listen to rock until I got to college. It was all country music. We wore cowboy hats and boots and all that usual stuff. And it was just this way of life and this culture that somehow I thought that all the people who were flooding down into Texas during the deindustrialization of the United States, in the 80s especially, were moving there for jobs, that they were bringing alien ways and alien cultures. And for a lot of Texans, that was our big concern, that somehow we were going to lose our food, our music, our culture, our language, and all that was rapidly disappearing, and there was nothing left to that. There was a chiropractor by the name of Paul Parsons who wrote the book called Back Pain Chronicles. He was a chiropractor, talked about that. But he said something once I liked. He says, you know, be careful of the environment you choose because that environment is changing you. Be careful of the environment you choose because that environment is changing you. And I kind of think, he was talking about back pain, but I thought, you know, that makes sense to a lot of other environmental issues that we need to be careful. And the fact is that changes were coming to Texas whether I wanted them or not. And I should work for the good environment of the types of things that were healthy and were making it a much better place there than just simply fighting everything because it was changed. Last week, the National Park Service invited me out to Shepherdstown, West Virginia at the National Conservation Training Center because it was the 110th celebration of the Appalachian Trail, and they're writing a new document to talk about the Appalachian Trail's history. The Appalachian Trail runs from Springer Mountain in Georgia all the way up to Mount Katahdin in Maine, about 2,200 miles. It varies and changes quite a bit. And there's a very interesting history about that. It was built in, it was actually conceived by a guy by the name of Benton McKay. Benton McKay wrote an article in 1921 in an architectural journal saying that we should create an Appalachian Trail that's going to run from Maine to Georgia by American cities. And he thought that because he thought that we New Yorkers and people living in dense cities needed a place to get out and just under our own movement walk along a trail because they thought that was good for us. Ben McKay in that original article, of course, mentions the New England Transcendentalist who thought that nature was a great teacher and he wanted to get in. He thought he wanted to do that. What's also fascinating about the Appalachian Trail is if you think of most national parks, they're actually run or managed by National Park Service rangers. The Appalachian Trail was one of the largest construction projects in America, in the world's history, that was done entirely by volunteers. 2,200 miles that were built by volunteers, and to this day is maintained by volunteer clubs. So there are a number of clubs in the Appalachian Trail Conservancy They divided up the Appalachian Trail into regions. They all get together and they create and train volunteers who go up and maintain the trail. It truly is this very, very American thing. But Ben Mackay thought that the reason why he liked that idea that we would build it and it would be maintained not by the government and not by business, but by us, is he thought that the activity of engaging and building and maintaining the environment would bring out kind of the better sides of us. And it was not just hiking and thinking, oh, wow, isn't this beautiful, I'm glad this trail existed, but that we all needed to work to make that beauty happen, that we had to create that space. Benton Mackay, in the original 1921 article, said that he thought of this idea because he visited a place called Hudson Guild Farm. Hudson Guild Farm, for those of you who are nodding in the room as ethical culturists know, was founded by John Lloyd Elliott and by this society, the New York Society for Ethical Culture, to take people from the city, and the Hudson Guild was in Chelsea, and to help people get jobs, things like that. But the original ethical culturists thought you needed to go out to the trail. They created the Hudson Guild Farm, and you went out there, you grew food, and you lived, and you worked together to make this beautiful place, and it inspired him to put that through. So I think it's something we have to do. For me as an environmentalist, everything we do is about engaging. If you don't want fracking, change your light bulbs. Right? If you don't want all these the Keystone Pipeline, change your light bulbs. If you don't want those things, there's something you could do by going in your house and reducing your energy by 20% by changing your light bulbs. And we have the means to do that. If you don't like contact fluorescence, use LEDs because we can do that. So how many psychiatrists does it take to change a light bulb? It just takes one, but the bulb really has to want to change. I think there's a lesson